High noon has come this 14th day of October 1066, the hour when William, Duke of Normandy, and Harold, King of England, will meet here at the instigation of His Holiness, Pope Alexander II. We still don't know whether this meeting is a sign that William and Harold have agreed on a peaceful settlement of their dispute. Harold, the Earl of Wessex, holds the English throne. William claims it. This was to have been the day of decision by arms, but the Pope's emissary, Bishop Lanfranc, arrived in the Norman camp, and soon thereafter this meeting between Harold and William was arranged. Since then, there has been no statement from either the Duke of Normandy or from the Pope's emissary which told the full story behind this dramatic last-minute conference.
October 14th, 1066, Hastings, England. You are there.
William of Normandy and his French army face Harold of Wessex and his English host. CBS takes you back 883 years to the meeting that decided which of these two nobles would become the undisputed King of England. All things are as they were then, except for one thing. When CBS is there,
you are there.
You Are There, produced and directed by Robert Louis Cheyan, is based on authentic historical facts and quotations. And now,
a new camp at Hastings Hill, England, and on holiday.
A contest produced, if any, which would induce King Harold to discuss a peaceful settlement. Reports from the English lines time and again have quoted the Earl of Wessex as saying he has nothing to discuss. And he has been further quoted as saying, if William wants the throne of England, he'll have to fight for it. And that's precisely what William had planned to do today until the unexpected arrival of the Pope's emissary. John Daly's at the scene of the rendezvous in neutral territory on Hastings Hill, and he reports now that William is arriving, so come in, John Daly.
The Duke of Normandy has left his lines at the bottom of Hastings Hill and is coming up to this rendezvous, located midway up the hill between the two armies. King Harold at the crest and the Duke of Normandy's men down there at the foot. The Duke is mounted on a pure white charger and his official retinue apparently is coming with him. Bishop Lanfranc, the Pope's emissary, rides at William's right. I can also recognize William Fitzover, the Duke's chief steward. And there's Count Alain of Fargon, the leader of the Breton contingent in the Norman army. We call it the Norman army, although William has drawn his men from every corner of the Gallic provinces. The Duke is dismounted. In a moment, he will pass here, and we hope to be able to ask him a few questions. He wears a white surcoat over his chainmail armor. William and Harold will meet at a council table set up at this point. It's a bright autumn day here at Hastings, and now... Oh, my lord!
Yes?
My lord, has King Harold agreed to give up the throne?
Harold, the Earl of Wessex, agreed to nothing, except to meet with Bishop Lanfranc.
Well, then His Highness is not meeting with you. He is coming here to talk only with the Pope's emissary.
That is correct. I, too, am here only at the Holy Father's behest.
But has there been no basis agreed upon in advance for this meeting, sir?
None whatever. The Earl of Essex and I have agreed to meet solely for the purpose of hearing a message from His Holiness.
And do you know what that message contains, sir?
I do not.
Well, suppose the Pope urges that you and King Harold divide England between you. Will you agree to that?
Absolutely not. I am the rightful King of England. All Christendom knows that King Edward, who has just died, God rest his soul, was my cousin. We are the same blood. Before Edward died, he promised that I would inherit his throne.
But, my lord, Harold claims that King Edward promised him the throne.
If that be true, and I doubt it, my royal cousin was promising something he had no right to bestow. Harold is not of royal blood. His father's father was a swineherd.
But if I may, my lord, was not Harold elected king by the English Council of Lords and Prelates?
Elected? Quelle idée! How can you elect a king? Kings are divinely appointed to rule, not elected.
Then is it true that no matter what the Pope may say, you still intend to be king?
Let us say that before this day is out, I shall be King of England or dead.
Thank you, my lord. And now I'm going to try to ask the Pope's emissary, Bishop Lanfranc, a question. My Lord Bishop, will you tell us, sir, please, what message you have brought from the Holy Father in Rome?
Not now, my son. Later.
Are you going to propose a division of England between Harold and William?
All in good time. Later, my
son. There is a rumor, my Lord Bishop, that His Holiness favors the Duke of Normandy in this dispute. Is that true?
The Holy Father does not favor one of his children over the other.
Then why has the Pope intervened?
The Holy Father, ever mindful of the welfare of his children, desires that the succession to the throne of England be decided without the useless shedding of innocent blood.
Thank you, my Lord Bishop. The Bishop Lanfranc has joined the Duke of Normandy at the conference table. They seem impatient. William has risen. He's pacing the ground near the table, talking to his officers. It's now 5 minutes past the agreed time. The tension here is great. One can't help wondering what the feeling is down there at the foot of the hill among the men of William's army. There are 8,000 fighting men down there ready for battle. Approximately 5,000 of them are barons and knights, the remaining 3,000 mostly free men. And Ken Roberts is down there among them, so we switch you now to Ken Roberts.
Out of all this French-speaking host, I've been able to find a few who speak English. So suppose we ask them how they feel about this peace conference. First, here is the Chevalier Hugh de France, a Norman knight. Is that correct, sir?
Oui. Oui, merci. I am from Normandy.
I see. And will you tell us how it happens that you speak English?
A fighting man learns many languages, monsieur. My third is for hire.
You mean that you're a mercenary?
They call it what you may, monsieur. Is one of the oldest professions, no? Is what you might call the trade of second son.
Why do you say that, sir?
Because in Avranches, where I come from, my elder brother Roland, by the right of, primogeniture.
Primogeniture, you mean?
Primogeniture, oui. By that right, my brother inherits all my father's castles and lands. So, what is left for a poor second son to do but to wander up and down everywhere? Fighting a little here, a little there. That's how I make my living.
And that is why you come to England?
Oui, monsieur. I hope that this will be my last employment. I want land and retainers of what they are. The Duke of Normandy has promised me plenty of both here in England, and for that, I fight for him.
Well, it appears, however, Chevalier de France, that you may not fight today. If the conference results in peace,
peace
you will
have... or war, it does not matter. So long as William becomes king and pays me my land. Personally, I think this English Earl of Wessex is frightened and means to bargain. Third, if he does not bargain, also war. We fight. To me, it does not matter, so long as I get my land.
Thank you, sir. And now, here's a man from the province of Anjou, a freeman, a foot soldier. His name is Raoul de Marnac. He wears a leather jerkin over a quilted shirt, and he's armed with a sword and dagger. Have you also been promised land in return for your services, de Marnac?
No.
Then you fight because you believe in William's cause.
Everybody in William's army believes in William's cause.
I see. You volunteered.
No.
Then why are you here?
I am here because I am a retainer of the Comte d'Anjou. My lord is a liegeman of the Duke of Normandy. The Duke of Normandy brought my lord, and my lord brought me. I am giving him the military service I owe him.
Well, I thought the customary term of service due a lord from his free man is 40 days a year.
That is true.
You've been away from home almost 3 months.
That is also true.
You must be very anxious to return to Anjou.
How would you feel, monsieur, if you had a wife and children at home and no land? Nothing to gain here on this island but death.
I understand. Thank you, de Marnac. I hope you get home to your wife and children.
Merci. I hope so, too.
Well, I've just received word that King Harold has not reached the rendezvous yet, but my colleague, Don Hollenbeck, at the news camp behind William's line, has been granted permission to interview an English prisoner who was captured recently. And so over to Don Hollenbeck.
This prisoner is Swain of Kent. He's a member of that famous body of Harold's troops known as the Housecarls. The Housecarls are picked soldiers, Harold's palace guards. They're the elite of his army. I'm told it took 6 Normans to overcome Sir Swain, and I can well believe that. He's nearly 7 feet tall. He must weigh 300 pounds, all of it apparently muscle. He's wearing a steel helmet and a leather jacket armed with steel discs. Sir Swain, you don't seem a bit upset by the fact that you've been taken prisoner.
The scoundrels caught me by surprise. I'll not be a prisoner long.
Well, is that because you think this meeting between Harold and William will end in peace?
Peace? There'll be no peace. Unless the Norman invader turns tail and runs for home like a whipped dog.
Oh, you regard the Duke of Normandy's army as an army of invasion.
Well, what would you regard it? There's not an Englishman among them. They come from all over Europe. They come to steal our lands and to make us slaves.
Slaves, huh? Well, I've heard there is more slavery in England than there is anywhere else in the Christian world.
We have slaves, yes, but they're Saxons.
Oh, I see. By the way, are you an Englishman? It seems to me that Swain is a Danish name.
My father was a Dane.
How did he come to England?
He came with King Canute.
Oh, Canute. Wasn't Canute the leader of a Danish army of invasion that plundered England?
Yes, but that
And
was
didn't
a...
King Canute drive out Ethelred, the Saxon king of England, and put himself on the throne?
That all happened 50 years ago. Now the Danes who came here are English. This is our home.
Well, apparently the English earls of Northumbria and Mercia don't agree with you. They've refused to acknowledge
that.
Harold as their sovereign. They point out that he himself is the son of a Danish woman. And
Just a minute.
Here's the report of activity up at the top of Hastings Hill, so back to John Daly.
Harold and his men are riding down now to this meeting place. He has only four knights with him, enormously tall and powerful men. They must be house cows, like the prisoner John Hollenbeck was just talking to. Each knight is carrying a battle axe, and they're by far the biggest battle axes I've ever seen. The blades must measure, at least 16 inches across. Harold himself is in armor. This will be the first time that the Earl of Wessex, King Harold, the Duke of Normandy, have come face to face since 2 years ago when Harold was a guest in William's court. Harold, as you remember, had been shipwrecked on the French coast, and as is the custom with strangers shipwrecked on a foreign shore, he was held for ransom by one of William's noblemen. He'd probably have been put to death if the Duke of Normandy had not personally intervened and invited him to the Norman court. There, Harold and William became fast friends, and Harold, before departing for England, even took an oath that he would support William's claim to the throne of England when the question of a successor to the then reigning King Edward should arise. Harold has arrived, dismounted. He kneels before Bishop Lanfranc and kisses the ring on his finger. The bishop bids him rise, and Harold has now seated himself at the council table opposite the Duke of Normandy. The two men, once friends, now bitter enemies, are staring at each other. Neither has uttered a word. Bishop Lanfranc speaks.
I bring ye greetings from His Holiness Pope Alexander. His Holiness instructed the court of cardinals in Rome to investigate the merits of the rival claims to the English throne. It is the judgment of His Holiness, of the Supreme Pontiff, of Christ, Vicar upon earth, that the rightful and lawful successor to the throne of England is William, Duke of Normandy.
I protest, my Lord Bishop. Neither I nor my liegemen were represented at the court of cardinals.
But, my son, you were invited, and you did not choose to come or to send ambassadors.
Aye, verily. What jurisdiction has the court of cardinals in Rome over the temporal affairs of my realm in England?
Softly. Do you dare challenge the authority of the Supreme Pontiff?
On what basis? On what basis, I ask, did the cardinals make their finding?
On the basis of William's blood relationship to the late King Edward. You yourself did recognize this relationship and its inevitable fruits of rightful succession.
Not true! Not true!
Witnesses, my son, unimpeachable witnesses, did testify that on the 8th day of May in the year of our Lord 1064, at the court of William, you swore an oath to support in all ways his claim to the throne of England when that throne should become vacant.
Yes, I swore the oath, but I swore it under duress, and it is therefore not binding. Had I refused to swear fealty to William, he would have had me murdered.
You lie! You took the oath of your own free will, out of gratitude because I saved your life.
Gratitude? To you? All Christendom knows you for a poisoner.
You dare call me a poisoner? You who could not even wait until Edward was cold in his grave before you seized his tower and thrust it upon your head in guilty hate?
I was elected.
You usurper! You
let your life die out of your hands.
Stand there and listen to me.
Harold, Earl of Wessex, I read you this message from His Holiness. I, Pope Alexander II, do hereby call upon Harold, Earl of Wessex, to relinquish the throne which he has taken unlawfully. I further call upon Harold, Earl of Wessex, to disband his army and submit to William, Duke of Normandy. Should the said Harold, Earl of Wessex, refuse to do so, we will place a sentence of greater excommunication upon him.
My Lord Bishop, I am a humble and obedient vassal of the Holy Father in all matters but this.
Consider carefully, my son. As an excommunicant, You will be denied the spiritual rights and comforts of the church. Internment in consecrated ground. The civil right to make wills and to sue in the court. You will be shunned by servants, friends, and family. You will be an outcast, and the faithful shall call you Antichrist.
Call me what you will. I am King of England, and King I will remain.
Harold has turned his back on the conference. He is walking away, defying Rome, defying excommunication, and the... That's William who cried out, "Wait, Harold, wait. King Harold has turned, and
offer.
Now William is speaking.
Listen to my offer. Surrender the crown of England. In return, you may keep the earldom of Wessex. In addition, you shall have all the lands beyond the Humber River. You shall be the greatest earl in my realm. You shall stand at the foot of my throne by my right hand. We shall be brothers in arms. I make this offer to you because of our former friendship.
Keep your friendship.
And I will keep my throne.
Then let us at least avoid a bloody battle in which thousands of my liegemen and yours will die. I challenge you to single combat. The victor will be king.
Single combat? Have you no faith in the valor of your army? Did you bring your host from France to challenge me to single combat? My throne is there, at the crest of Hastings Hill, defended by my valiant men. If you would sit upon that throne, climb the hill and conquer, if you can.
The peace conference has failed. William and Harold and their knights are going to return to their lines, and the sword alone will now decide who is to be the King of England. The battle will be fought here. Just when, it's impossible to say. It may even break and flow over this field at any moment. But down among William's men is now in the best position to follow this fast-developing action, so go ahead, Robert.
The Duke of Normandy is coming up to his line. His trumpets are sounding attention. It's hardly necessary, because every baron, knight, and foot soldier is anxiously waiting to learn what William will do now that the peace conference has failed. The Duke of Normandy is reined up in front of his men. He raises his hand. William is speaking. William has just told his men of Harold by defying the Pope is to become the Antichrist. The Duke has been handed a banner. It's the Pope's banner, a great gold cross in a field of blue. Now William again. William just announced that he has ordered the Norman fleet to sea. There is no possibility of return to France.
Of their bowstrings as they pour arrows into the English.
Their arrows are arched high into the air. They drop almost vertically among the English housecarls up there on top of the hill. And those arrows are having their desired and planned effect. The housecarls have been forced to raise their shields as a protective roof to protect their heads and their faces. And even so, housecarls are dropping. But still, others take the places of those who have fallen. And now the Norman archers are fanning out, opening a path directly into the center of the hill. They're blocking my line of vision. I can't see clearly, but Ken Roberts should be opposite me across the hill and slightly below where he can see. So over to Ken Roberts.
The Norman foot soldiers, with their shields and swords, are charging up the hill, racing up that path opened a moment ago by the archers. And behind them, the mounted Norman knights, lances set. Line after line of horsemen galloping wildly, pennants and banners flying in the wind. William is there somewhere in the center of the vanguard. I can see the blue and gold banner of the Pope. And now boulders, enormous rocks, are raining down upon the charging Norman horsemen and foot soldiers. The English must have loosed their catapults. They're taking a heavy toll of the Normans. But the charge, the magnificent charge of William's men up the hill continues. In a moment, the two great forces will collide. Go ahead, John Daly.
Two armies have collided, have crashed head-on. Norman horsemen are knifing their way into the first line of housecarls, and the English, stunned by the shock of the blow, are falling under the lances and under the horses' hoofs. But now the Normans are being engulfed, swallowed up by the sheer mass of English soldiers up on the top of the hill, up there, lying about them with their heavy, mighty battle axes. More and more Normans keep coming up, more and more of them. And everywhere I look now, there are great, surging crowds of Normans and English giving and receiving blows, the great battle axes showing for a moment above the melee and then swinging down. It's almost impossible to draw a coherent picture out of such a savage and chaotic scene. Still in the thick of the fighting flies that blue and gold banner of the Pope. Under it is the white charger of the Duke of North. Now William has been struck down. At least he's fallen from his horse. And from here, it's impossible to tell whether the Duke has been struck or has been killed. If he has, it may mean catastrophe to the Norman forces. Ken Roberts is closer to that scene of action. Perhaps he can tell us. Go ahead, Ken Roberts.
I can't see the Duke of Normandy. The housecarls, the Normans, are fighting furiously around the spot where William fell. The Normans are wavering. They're giving way now. Many of them are falling back in confusion. Soldier! Soldier, what's happened to the Duke of Normandy? Who is the Duke of Normandy?
The Duke is lost! Let me see if they do!
William has been killed, the soldier said. The battle is lost. The entire Norman line is falling back in complete confusion. All of the Normans must have seen their Duke down. The English housecarls are seizing the advantage, striking with redoubled fury, and the Norman retreat is turning into a rout. The Normans have turned their backs on the enemy. They're fleeing down the hill, running past me in panic. And now, here come the English, led by the giant housecarls. They're pouring down on foot from the top of the hill, pursuing the Normans. And Harold himself is leading them. He must be supremely confident of victory to have left his fixed position. The English have overtaken the Normans now. They're cutting them down with their huge battle axes. The Normans are being slaughtered. William, Duke of Normandy, is dead, and his army is dying with him. This position is becoming dangerous, so I'll switch you back to John Daly on the other side of the hill. Go ahead, Daly.
We'll try it here.
This is Don Hollenbeck at the news camp behind the Norman lines. Go ahead, John Daly. Come in, John Daly. It's entirely possible the English may have swept over John Daly's position, too. As you heard Ken Roberts report, William, Duke of Normandy, has been killed. The Normans are in full flight. The entire news camp here is breaking up. The Normans seem to be hopelessly trapped.
Before the battle began, William ordered the Norman fleet out to sea, so there's no possibility of escape in that direction. Unless the Normans can perform a miracle, reform their lines, it's possible every last man of them will be killed or captured, and there's doubt here whether any prisoners will actually be taken. Harold had sworn to be merciless. The best any prisoner can hope for is slavery. Just a minute. We've established contact with John Daly. He's ready to report again, so go ahead, John Daly.
William is alive. The Duke of Normandy is alive. From this new position at the foot of Hastings Hill, we can see the Norman leader riding a new horse. A short while ago, at the very height of the Norman panic, he reappeared suddenly, rode widely into the confused and fleeing Normans, tore off his helmet and cried out, "I am alive! I am alive!" And then he rallied his men, formed his lines again, stemmed, held, and turned the English tide of conquest. The English, out of their fixed positions at the top of the hill, on foot, have suddenly found themselves at the mercy of the resurgent Normans. I'm going to try to get up there to the center of the fighting. Meanwhile, I'm told that Ken Roberts can report again from the other side of the hill. Go ahead, Roberts.
The Norman knights are surrounding the English. The English, on foot, are helpless against the charging, rearing cavalry of William. They're trapped. The English are trapped. The French are herding them into a dense, disorganized mass, striking them down. Harold has fallen. His horse has been struck from under him, and his house calls are losing heart. Their resistance is weakening. Some of them are throwing away their arms, and the Normans are pressing the advantage. The fall of King Harold and the faltering of the house calls is having its effect on the mass of English soldiers. They are beginning to run away now in all directions. The last signs of organized English resistance is disappearing, and only a few house calls are still fighting around the flag of their fallen commander. But now they too are being cut down one by one, and the Normans are reaching for the English banner. It's down. The banner is down. And John Daly has moved up to the center of the fighting, so go ahead, Daly.
William's blue and gold banner has just been lifted over the very spot where Harold fell. The Earl of Wessex is dead, killed by a Norman arrow, and that is definite. Here is the Duke of Normandy himself. Here is William. This is a glorious moment for you, sire. You snatched victory from the very jaws of defeat.
Defeat, never. The issue was never in danger.
But the retreat, sire, your flight from the top of the hill.
A stratagem, sir, a maneuver. Planned in advance to crush the English from their roots, and crush them it did. The fact that I was shot from my horse only helped to fool the English.
Thank you, your highness.
But you won't survive. The bomb on the tail, you have left here.
Congratulated his men, and they're now hailing him, calling him William the Conqueror. And conqueror he is today. The Duke of Normandy is the new King of England by right of conquest. Nothing stands now between him and the throne and the crown.
October 14, 1066. William the Conqueror wins the Battle of Hastings, and the Middle Ages begin.
You have been listening to The Battle of Hastings, another broadcast in the series You Are There, produced and directed by Robert Louis Cheyenne. The Battle of Hastings was written by Michael Sklar and Mr. Cheyenne. Guy Sorrell played William of Normandy, Dot Cotsworth was Harold of Wessex, and the cast included William Podmore, Oliver Cliff, John Merlin, Peter Hobbs, Alfred de la Fuente, and others. Next week,
April 7, 1498, Florence, Italy. The plot to kill Savonarola. You are there.
CBS's 10 great shows on Sunday nights are built around outstanding talent in show business.